In an earlier talk, Chasing the Dragon, linked below, Peter Wright and I outlined Nicholas Tinbergen's concept of the supernormal stimulus, or superstimulus, which he characterized as an exaggerated environmental stimulus to which there's an existing tendency in animals to respond, or a stimulus that elicits a response more strongly than the stimulus for which it evolved. And that may sound a little convoluted, but Tinbergen demonstrated the phenomena by placing a larger artificial egg in the nest of an oyster catcher bird. The oyster catcher lays several eggs and then chooses the largest one to incubate. The bird made fruitless attempts to retrieve the oversized egg and place it in the nest while neglecting its own real normal-sized eggs. Even though giant eggs never occur in nature, larger eggs are usually healthier, so the animal generally improves its genetic success by retrieving a larger egg first. In another experiment, Tinbergen placed a football-sized egg in the nest of a herring gull, who showed preference for the grotesquely large egg, even though it was unable to move it, and kept sliding off when attempting to sit on it. Supernormal stimuli are bigger or more intense than normal in color, shape, texture, or smell, eliciting an abnormally exaggerated response from the animal or human. We referred to that exaggerated response as a super response, one that, applied to humans, contributes to the increasing discord, unhappiness, and confusion among men and women today. Just like the herring gull, we are sliding off the egg in every which way, failing to identify the mechanism behind it. Humans are wired to respond to superstimuli, having numerous biological tendencies that can be misdirected through the deployment of an artificial stimulus. Even in the beginning, human babies will smile at an oval cardboard cutout with two dark circles where eyes should be, providing one of the earliest examples of the human face as a sign stimulus and a releaser of the innate response mechanism. Think also of the nipple to which the human baby automatically gropes and begins sucking, and of the larger-than-normal plastic pacifier that infants will hungrily suck as an example of the superstimulus at work. No breast, no milk, indeed no mother, but it will pacify just the same. Examples of the phenomena multiply as humans mature, acquiring as they do a habituated attraction to superstimuli that the modern world is now manufacturing on a scale unprecedented in human history. All of this, we think, foments the kind of unsustainable lunacy that now characterizes human interactions, especially those which are sexual in nature. Attempts to deconstruct the insanity abound, but almost none seem to be making a difference to our relational malaise. While offering some sharp observations, the theorizing from gender studies departments, nutty liberals, politicians, religious conservatives, or evolutionary psychologists have done little to explain the root biological mechanisms for the madness, and that's where supernormal stimuli and their unhealthy growth in the modern world might provide a new area of exploration and discussion. One reason for avoiding discussion of the supernormal stimulus theory may be that people like to rest on more mechanistic, determinist, and ultimately reductionist explanations for human behavior, preferring, as they do, a less manipulable lock-and-key explanation. That approach eschews the ramifications of supernormal stimulus that would place more onus on a variable environment and its manipulations in regards to human behavior. Those with a reductive bent might like to fool themselves into believing that infant pacifiers, artificial intelligence, silicone breasts, cosmetics, and sex bots have been with us since the Pleistocene, but of course such superstimuli are relatively new to the human species. Evolutionary psychologists, for example, especially those cherishing a fantasy of traditional gender roles to guide and ultimately bias their research, tend to omit the theory of superstimuli from their discourse because it indicates primal urges can and do overrun their evolutionary purpose. For example, pathological displays in even traditional gender relations as a case in point. The operation of the supernormal stimulus reveals the normal biological response of traditional evolutionary sex roles to be a pathological perversion, in which case the theory is swiftly overlooked. That move, however, leaves a lacuna in the theoretical base of evolutionary psychology, and its research results may equally suffer. DIERDRE BARRETT, author of Supernormal Stimuli, How Primal Urges Overran Their Evolutionary Purpose, linked, remarks that many evolutionary concepts have been applied to human behavior either formally in evolutionary psychology or have just crossed over into popular conversation. However, the importance of superstimuli, states Barrett, doesn't seem to have been fully appreciated in either of those arenas. She also states, and we quote, "Evolutionary psychology has picked up a lot of Darwin's ideas and some ethology ideas, which is the Darwinian branch of animal behavior that Tinbergen was a part of. But somehow, evolutionary psychology never adopted the idea of supernormal stimuli, and I really think that of all the evolutionary concepts, it's the most important and the most directly relevant to human behavior." End of quote. Independently of Barrett, we've been applying the concept to human populations and with her believe it to be the most important and relevant fact to human behavior today, particularly as it shows in the addict-like behaviors plaguing modern humans and relationships. While the influence of superstimuli is responsible for a range of destructive and potentially anti-species outcomes, it is not altogether new. Observe, for example, the Venus of Willendorf, whose exaggerated body parts would have elicited a possible super response in those who carved and first gazed upon her. Think also of the cave paintings of Lascaux with their stylized renditions of animals, or of shamans dressed in animal costumes, not to mention the ritual enactments of animal behaviors in traditional cultures who routinely adorned themselves with animal skins or feathers and engaged in theatric play that would have acted as a supernormal stimuli inducing longing, wonder, fear, or hunger in the audience. Mythology itself has been suggested as a form of supernormal stimuli, a position forwarded by the late Joseph Campbell in his Masks of the Gods series. There he states, and I'm going to quote this in its entirety despite the fact that it's lengthy and sometimes hard to follow. "There's a phenomenon known to the students of animal behavior as the supernormal sign stimulus, which has never been considered, as far as I know, in relation to either art or poetry or to myth, yet which in the end may be our surest guide to the seat of their force. Within the field of study of animal behavior, which is the only area in which controlled experiments have made it possible to arrive at dependable conclusions in the observations of instinct, two orders of innate releasing mechanisms, or IRMs, have been identified, namely the stereotyped and the open, subject to imprint. In the case of the first, a precise lock-key relationship exists between the inner readiness of the nervous system and the external sign stimulus triggering response, so that if there exist in the human inheritance many or even any IRMs of this order, we may justly speak of inherited images in the psyche. The mere fact that no one can yet explain how such lock-key relationships are established does not invalidate the observation of their existence. No one knows how the hawk got into the nervous system of our barnyard fowl, yet numerous tests have shown it to be de facto there. However, the human psyche has not yet been to any great extent satisfactorily tested for such stereotypes, and so I'm afraid pending further study, we must simply admit that we do not know how far the principle of the stereotyped inherited image can be carried when interpreting mythological universals. The concept of the sign stimulus as an energy-releasing and directing image clarifies, however, the difference between literary metaphor, which is addressed to the intellect, and mythology, which is aimed primarily at the central excitatory mechanisms or CEMs, and IRMs of the whole person. According to this view, a functioning mythology can be defined as a corpus of culturally maintained sign stimuli fostering the development and activation of a specific type or constellation of types of human life. Furthermore, since we now know that no images have been established unquestionably as innate, that our IRMs are not stereotyped but open. Whatever universals we may find in our comparative study must be assigned to common experience rather than endowment. While on the other hand, even where sign stimuli may differ, it need not follow that the responding IRMs differ too. Our science is to be simultaneously biological and historical throughout, with no distinction between culturally conditioned and instinctive behavior. Since all instinctive human behavior is culturally conditioned, and what is culturally conditioned in us all is instinct, specifically the CEMs and IRMs of this single species. End of quote. As we detailed in Chasing the Dragon, nascent experimentation with superstimuli by our remote ancestors slowly increased from stone carvings, shaman costumes, and mythological imagery, and went into overdrive in the Middle Ages with the birth of mass-produced cosmetics, the fashion industry, romantic love tropes, and invention of the printing press, linked. That revolution has been furthered by the invention of electricity and its mediums of cinema, radio, television, internet, cell phone, and the gaming console, all serving the superstimulus forms of the culture in which they were born. In Chasing the Dragon, we reviewed three domains of human instinct that have been hypnotized by the creation of superstimuli. Briefly reviewed as follows, these are 1. Neoteny and the parental instinct. While there are notable exceptions, adult women are not generally endowed with neotenous features sufficient to provoke men to find them cute in the way of a small child. Artifice, however, makes up for it by allowing women to imitate the features of children through the application of cosmetics or cultivation of childish gestures, linked, with the ultimate aim of shirking responsibility and being cared for by a man and society with the least amount of effort on her part. Naturally, such a routine robs her of agency, parentifies the man, and becomes a drag on relationships. Linked. Linked below is a segment from an instruction video for women from the Fascinating Womanhood movement, and it provides an example of how this biological ruse, essentially a feigned neoteny, is a result of cultural learning. Watch from 1 minute 37 seconds to 2 minutes 33 seconds. The instruction for women to feign childlikeness, linked, is now endemic in the Western world, which may account, at least partially, for the tradition of women and children first. A statement that captures not only that women look after children, but that they themselves are children in need of saving. In which sense, the phrase might be more accurately rendered as children and children first. 2. Sexual stimuli and sexual arousal. We regularly see hand-wringing about the increase in skimpy, sexualized clothing among women and even young girls, along with a booming trend in tummy tucks, butt implants, Botox injections, lip augmentation, and boob jobs. We're told that women become overtly reliant on these powerful methods of superstimulating men's sexuality, and we are equally told that this makes sex like a powerful drug and leads to sex addiction. In a sense, they are not completely wrong. The supersizing of sexual phenomena do result in an addiction-like intensity, or what we've called the super response. Many men and MGTOW have said no to the exploitative potential that comes with female use of super stimuli. Men who ironically opt out of relationships with real women in favor of more super stimuli in the form of internet porn and neotenous sex bots. Super stimuli over which they secure full control. While a certain degree of superstimuli may prove healthy in catering to one's sexual needs, it is up to each man to determine whether the stimuli are catering to a healthy expression of needs or to an overly intense superstimulus and unhealthy response in the form of addiction. 3. Pair bonding, secure and insecure. In the pre-medieval period, simple courtship practices and arranged marriages ruled, linked, leaving little room for the supernormal exaggerations of attachment security that we see in practice today. Modern rules for pair bonding are encapsulated in the notion of romantic love, which unfortunately turns out to be a cornucopia of destructive superstimuli. Romantic love is geared to fostering an extreme tension between feelings of possessing and losing a pair bond. Linked, it relies on an oscillation between secure and insecure attachment that generates a supernormal intensity of lovers' feelings for each other, with the downside of inner turmoil and insecurity that feeds relational dysfunction and not infrequently psychological illnesses. The poets are not lying when they say that love is like a roller coaster. Frank Tallis's book Lovesick, Love as a Mental Illness, Linked, elaborates on the kind of pathologies that come hand in hand with the romantic love-based approach to pair bonding. From the blurb on Tallis's book, we read as follows, quote, "Obsessive thoughts, erratic mood swings, insomnia, loss of appetite, recurrent and persistent images and impulses, superstitious or ritualistic compulsions, delusion, the inability to concentrate, that exhibiting just 5 or 6 of these symptoms is enough to merit a diagnosis of a major depressive episode. Yet we all subconsciously welcome these symptoms when we allow ourselves to fall in love." In Lovesick, Dr. Frank Tallis considers our experiences and our expressions of love and why the combinations of pleasure and pain, ecstasy and despair, rapture and grief have come to characterize what we mean when we speak of falling in love. Tallis examines why the agony associated with romantic love continues to be such a popular subject for poets, philosophers, songwriters, and scientists, and questions just how healthy our attitudes are and whether there may be, in fact, more sane, less tortured ways to love. A highly informative exploration of how, throughout time, principally in the West, the symptoms of mental illness have been used to describe the state of being in love. This book offers an eloquent, thought-provoking, and endlessly illuminating look at one of the most important aspects of human behavior. End of quote. Tallis traces the sickness-making version of pair bonding to its origin in the Middle Ages, linked, and rightly suggests there are less tortured ways to love. Humans have, of course, loved less torturously in the long past, and we might hope it's possible to relate that way again in the stability and simplicity of a secure attachment. To love in that way, however, requires slaying the dragon, finding alternative modes of pair bonding to those we've been duped into following. Recognition of supernormal stimuli and of their proliferation in the modern world answers the why question, which leads us naturally to the question of what. What can we do to manage this biological and cultural travesty? As concluded in our previous talk, we can begin by recognizing we've been hypnotized by a stage show of sound and light and deciding that we no longer wish to indulge in it. As we suggested there, it's as simple as choosing not to chase the dragon, but to slay it. In essence, we can say the dragon represents our unmoderated appetite, given freely and stupidly over to the snares of superstimuli, and our thus far untapped discernment and discipline can serve as the sword of redress. Slaying the dragon demands we employ our substantial neocortexes, which are designed for overriding primitive impulses that lead us willy-nilly into pain and injury. With that, we can construct a defensive, self-protective approach toward the activities and the people we might choose to associate with, activating the traditional values of restraint, delayed gratification, conservation, and self-protection against the arrival of superstimuli in our field of vision. Think of it this way. By overriding our knee-jerk attraction to the false neoteny created by women's makeup and dress, we build in a defense against gynocentric obedience as well as a protective measure for screening out personality-disordered women from our lives. That is just one application of many. By that path, we may find a way forward, but also, strangely, a way back. Back to the protective values of past cultures, to Buddhist teachings about pleasure as an illusion and potential suffering, to the Christian teachings of the seven deadly sins and how to resist them, or to the messages of classical myth which invite us to hold fast to our values like Odysseus, linked, who tied himself to the ship's mast in order to resist the siren's call, knowing that all the boons of Penelope awaited him at Ithaca as a result of his intelligent avoidance of gratification. And that is it for this talk on Slaying the Dragon, with thanks to Peter Wright, whose unparalleled work on the history and etiology of gynocentrism has been shaping my thoughts and work for years. I'd like to remind those who benefit from these talks that they do require a lot of work. Your support through the Patreon and donation buttons below, in any amount, are very much appreciated. As always, gents, I hope you've enjoyed, even if you haven't, and we'll see you next time.